Today we're gonna talk about the upcoming rotating recruitment banner, aka RRR. In this video series, we are going to give the currently newest rotating recruitment banner a closer look, and quickly analyze and rate the characters on RateUp, as well as finishing it up by evaluating the banner as a whole, to determine if it's worth rolling on it or not. Here's a quick reminder about my rating tiers. For some quick explanations about these, please refer to this timestamp on my first rotating recruitment review, or just look into the description down below. This banner runs from the 23rd till the 30th of November, which is as usual only 1 week long, making carefully planning ahead on how you spend your yellow flares a very smart and also important move. On RateUp this time around, the 5 stars Maggie and Keating, and the 6-star Rorian, Roth. Now that the general information is out of the way, let's start by first going through the 5-star characters, who in this week are 1 Converter and 1 Support. First off, Maggie is a Fire Element Cross Converter, which means that her active skill converts tiles, knockbacks, and deals 450% damage to all enemies in a cross shape, till it hits the end of the map. And while this skill does let you convert a large number of tiles to red, it is at the cost of a really high 5-turn cooldown. But Maggie does actually have at least a little bit more to offer, as she does have detonator-like chains, and also her equip to supplement that, sometimes, because it does increase her CC damage by up to 5%, and also reduces CC trigger requirements by 1, but only every 8th combo, which is... pretty useless. And why 8? 8? 8? Late? Whatever. Let's make sure that we aren't late by quickly checking out her breakthroughs, which are the usual cross-converter ones, meaning by 1 turn reduced skill CD at BT2 and preemptive strike at max breakthrough. BT2 is always really good to have and makes cross-converters generally more usable, and MBT is the huge power spike that truly makes them a force to be reckoned with, as you can now profit from a huge amount of converted tiles directly on turn 1, which does also enable burst setups way easier. All in all, just the fact that she's a cross converter and that the rest of her kit is alright means that Maggie's, like all cross converters, at least a stronger Rorian. But always keep in mind that at max breakthrough, things change quite a lot, as this generally makes cross converters a whole lot stronger and very likely contenders for the core tier. Let's move on to the second 5-star on this banner. Keating are a 4-in-1 Thunder attribute support, and interesting to say the least, as they, besides being 4 abandoned church troublemakers, also offer the ability to generate a clone that aggroes enemies to it in a 3 surrounding cluster range. And all enemies that have 5 lotter marks on them are also slowed for 2 rounds. And I know, you probably want to know what these marks are and what they do. But before that, I do have to give you my 2 cents about this Shadow Clone Jutsu. Yes, we do live in a society after all. So, while being able to gather all enemies in one spot can be great for big burst combos, the 4-turn cooldown on this does seem a bit much, and not really that worth it. But like I mentioned before, we are still missing critical information. That's why we are now going to take a closer look at these lotter marks. Damn, these kids shrill off the Joker. I mean, the movie was pretty aight, but come on, that's enough. And speaking of enough, these marks are applied through Keating's chain, which is basically a weird limited sniper-ish one. But is this enough? You can stack 8 marks on your opponents, but to get that, to be fair, not that great slow, you need 5 whole stacks on your foes, and even your 12 plus chain only inflicts 3 of them, meaning that getting your stacks is pretty slow. No need to clap. But do these stacks do anything else? Yes, thankfully they do, as these 4 do have some more tricks in there. Slowly move backwards and run at full power when I say 3. But before that, I do have to tell you that their equip not only increases Thunder Element Aurorian's normal attack damage by up to 1.8%, but also allows them to sprinkle some Joker venom on all remaining foes when you kill one of them. And while this isn't that bad, and also makes their whole gimmick slightly more reliable, I do have to say that not so fast. Before we give Keating their final verdict, let's look at their breakthroughs. Keating's PT2 reduces their mic requirement for slow by 1, making it now 4, and also now inflicts paralysis onto foes with 6 marks, which is nice, but let's be honest here, slow isn't that great, and getting 6 stacks is going to take more effort than it's even worth. And finally, their Max BT changes the clone's aggro range to global, which is once again not that bad, but honestly not that big of an upgrade, as the difference between 3 clusters and global is only minimal at best. So, how good are these 4 devil spawns? While they are pretty interesting, all of this is just way too complicated and troublesome for a very simple aggro effect with some bonuses. If you really want to utilize a taunt, you're probably better off with just using Brock, making these 4 only average at best. Last but not least, let's talk about Wrath is a Thunder Element Sniper, and this is another one of these kinds of scenarios. So, let's get right into our inspection to make clear why Wrath is unfortunately, similarly to a previous case, one of the worst 6 stars in the game. And while this might sound like a bold statement, I do have enough claims to back it up, and I'm not going to let you hanging for too long, as our first evidence is her active skill. This skill is amazing on paper, because it lets her enter the overload state, which increases her CC damage by 50%, lets her attack the nearest enemy a second time with her chain, and also lasts for 2 whole rounds. Does anyone else feel a copyright claim by a certain call girl coming? Or is it only me? And all of this is honestly just like a godsend for a sniper, but it does have a massive 5 turn cooldown. But I do have to say that unlike to our last similar case, this active skill is actually insanely good, but having a downtime of 4 whole rounds is simply devastating, and already makes it seem like she's a weird fusion experiment gone wrong. And it gets even worse, as her chain isn't even that bad. I personally love splash damage on sniper chains, as it's one step closer to my dream of one day having ranged detonators. But if we compare these chains to a newer iteration of splash CCs, her scalings do seem a bit lacking, which is only made up by her chains having increased splash range during her overload state, which is pretty good, don't get me wrong, but we can't forget the downtime of 4 turns. 4. But there is light on the horizon, as we still have to go through her equipment, and this is more complicated than it needed to be, as it does give her an ammo system, which lets you gain 1 ammo at the start of every round, and 2 when you use Wrath's active skill, and finally 1 when a Fire or Thunder Aurorian uses a skill. But what exactly do these do, besides filling up your foes with holes? Well, in exchange for using 1 ammo, the damage of 1 CC is increased by up to 30%, and when she is in her, to be fair, very reoccurring overload state, she can actually consume up to 3 with only 1 chain. What are you doing with that gun? I know your name is Wrath, but come on, don't be that angry. Please put the gun down, I'm just telling the truth. You want me to talk about what? Fine. Wrath's BT3 reduces her active skill's cooldown by 1, making it now 4. And this is definitely at least a slight improvement, as this also means that you can use her skill at least 2 times in modes like CC. But Wrath does need more than just that, after all she's bleeding out right now, and I doubt that this bandaid will help. Wrath's Max BT on the other hand is interesting, as it doesn't upgrade her active, but instead her chains, by increasing the splash damage by 20%, which is good, but that's not the main issue regarding her whole kit, which sadly means that Wrath is still dying at this very moment. Nobody wants to help her, huh? Twidok, what are you doing here? Oh. All in all, Raph is a sniper that is best comparable to Icarus, because she did fly a bit too close to the sun, as her kit is almost insanely good, but concentrates way too much on her special state, which is bound to a crazy high cooldown. Which does remind me of Drona, but in her case it was a way lower CD, making it at least bearable. Even though it pains me to say this, she's only almost solid. As her chains are pretty good, but her damage is limited through a dumb ammo system, her active skill is the uncle that says he comes to your next birthday, but shows up 5 years late, and Luke is the new kid around the block that stole your job, meaning that she's sadly only average. And with that, let's wrap this whole thing up. In conclusion, Maggie's the only real highlight of the banner, as she's a cross-converter, but she really wants some breakthroughs. Keating And Raph is also part of the Benchwarmer gang, especially now with Luke basically doing her job, but better. So, now let us answer the main question regarding this banner. Should you roll? If we take everything that we just said into account, the final verdict is skip. Unless you want to try for a Maggie dupe. In that case, roll for the guaranteed 5-star, but be careful and take this with you. You will need it. And as usual, don't forget that if you really like and want any of these three, just go for them. Are you going to roll on this banner? If yes, I would love to hear why. If you disagree with anything or just have something to share, just comment down below. And as always, please like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video. That was all from me, have a nice day, and see you next time.